Hello, and welcome to the Legends of Valcia. Today is episode 37, and I'm going to unmute all my compatriots who were laughing at a joke because they didn't know the countdown was ending. I am Llama Chomp. I will be playing Harbeck Ironfest. He's a dwarf, and he's mighty, and makes brews which are also mighty. Above me is Eversor.
Hi, I'm Eversor. I will be playing Brieg, the less and less insane gnomish arcane trickster.
He's the sanest of any of us. Above him is Babs.
Hi, I'm Babs. I'll be playing Dinblade, the human ranger who was raised by wolves.
Over there in the corner is Nima.
Hey, I'm Nima. I will be playing Gergintius Smithson, the happy-go-lucky human fighter.
Above him is Flick.
Hey, everyone. I'm Flick. I'll be playing Tabrin, the human warlock that is ever-growing more crazy. Caster of magics. All
and
of them.
And with the green background is Lolash.
Hi, I'm Lolash. I'm the DM. I'm moving today. Last week, I was not because I was very sick and rugged up. But this week, I'm here to present all of the nasty things.
When you said I'm moving today, I thought that you meant, like, your house was in boxes, and right after the show, you're going to unplug the internet and run to, like, a new location to live. I was very confused.
I'm so close to doing that in the next couple of months and just, like, picking a place where I can get decent internet. But that's a story for another day.
You're moving to America? So...
America? Decent internet? Only if I move to Texas.
Well, comparatively decent.
last week on Legends of Valcia, it was quite a Brieg-centric episode, so why don't we hear from Eversor about what happened last week?
So last week, we started with our plan in action about how we were going to break in to the asylum in Terran in order to save or liberate Shadow's brother, the Starlight Singer, whose name I cannot remember for the life of me.
Tressen.
That's
like his
the one.
Beautiful flowing Tressen. Tresses of hair.
Right. I think it's because it's Tressen in Terran, and I keep trying to make those
starts
the
with
same.
T, ends with N. Fantasy words, can't tell them apart. The middle of fantasy words does not make any difference.
Right, so we were going to save Tressen. The plan, as we began, entailed Din and Brieg watching the river for supply barges that came down the river into Terran to supply the asylum and the town. In order to see if there was, like, some way we could stow aboard one of them or something. And the rest of the party in Terran, kind of observing the town and trying to get a feel for the patterns of the town and see if there was something that they could do to get us in an alternative method. Of course, the best laid plans of mice and men, as they say. Brieg was watching the river, playing with his newfound powers with his ring of water, when lo and behold a barge came by, and not only did it have supplies, it had a prisoner aboard. And Brieg, against his better judgment, decided that he just couldn't sit idly by and watch someone else get subjected to the tortures that happened in the asylum at Terran. So he acted in a very surreptitious and small way to try to save the prisoner, to release him. He just, like, barely loosened the guy's bindings on his hand, and that was enough because the guy was, like, super crazy powerful and summoned the riverbed to defeat his enemies and killed his two guards by enveloping them in stone and pulling them down to the bottom of the river. And then he formed a land bridge to walk across out of the river, and
Brieg was a little bit startled to see this. And the guy, once we got him ungagged, Din found us. The guy talked to Brieg for just a second, and then he looked at Din and said, "She's a child of the forest, isn't she?" And Brieg said, "Yes." And then he walked over and gave her a kiss on the forehead, and then turned and disappeared into a tree. It was a weird moment for everyone. And then Din noticed that she had a shiny emerald bracer that she did not have before on her arm, or bracelet, bracer, something. That we're pretty sure was the source of the guy's ability to manipulate the earth in the ways that he did. Much like my ring lets me manipulate water. Speaking of manipulating water, I decided that it would be a really good idea to save that boat in case we wanted it later, so I made the river deposit it nicely on the bank so that we could come back to it if we wanted it. It was pretty neat. And then Din and Brieg ran back to Terran to their meeting that was set up for that afternoon with Tabarin. So we met outside of the city, and I said, "We should go in and talk because everything has changed." So we went in and talked and came up with a new, completely different plan than our original plan, which was, hopefully in a few hours, the elves are going to notice that their shipment didn't show up, and they will go and investigate. When they go and investigate, we're going to sneak in using my newfound water powers. I'm going to make it so we can all breathe underwater. We're going to walk into the lake that the asylum sits in the middle of. We're going to sneak up onto the dock, bust in, bust out the prisoner, escape. And that is exactly what we did. We waited until a large contingent of elves, 36 of them all told, headed off to investigate their missing shipment. We walked into the lake, breathing the water, and climbed up onto the dock where the shipments would have landed.
His girlfriend.
There was a single guard there that Brieg... There was a single guard there that Brieg tried to magic away and failed, but then Harbeck succeeded in magicking him away with the most overpowered first level spell in the game, Command. He commanded him to swim.
Command is
unfortunately
strong.
Unfortunately for the guard, he was wearing full plate mail, and swimming in plate mail is difficult, it turns out, especially when there are five people that can breathe underwater and want you dead. So that's what happened. He tried to swim, and then he got pulled deeper underwater by Tabarin's spells, and then he got a rock dropped on him by Harbeck, and then Brieg stuck his little face underwater and watched him drown. And it was strangely satisfying for Brieg because he really, really hates the elves of the asylum in Terran, with a, I would say, irrational hatred, but I think it's actually pretty well justified.
It can be justified and irrational.
Okay, with a well-justified irrational hatred. Anyway, so then we picked a lock, we busted into the prison, all of the guards were gone because they all went to investigate what happened to their shipment, except for the apparently one guy that they left on the door out there, and a few more that were upstairs, but we weren't upstairs, so that wasn't a problem.
Joe, stay here and guard the door. It usually takes 40 of us, but you'll be fine here by yourself.
Joe was like, "Guys, can I stay and guard the dock? I think my girlfriend's watching tonight."
Lamachop's headcanon is that there was a elf maiden nearby in the town of Terran watching her gallant husband, boyfriend, lover, whatever, it's, guarding the asylum.
It's such an idyllic scene.
Stood up in the middle.
It's starlight, the lake shimmering, her beautiful elven guard in uniform on the dock standing at attention. How could she not look at him with love in her eyes? She has to. I mean, if she exists, that is what she's doing.
And as she gazed lovingly at her future husband, he just randomly dove into the drink and never resurfaced. She probably blames herself.
She saw him just commit suicide.
A minute going, he could be holding his breath. He's probably fine. He's going to come back up any second now.
I wonder if she stayed around to see dwarf, gnome, human pile onto the dock and run through the door she's guarding. Or if her grief had stricken her blind and she had stopped looking after he didn't surface and she didn't ever notice us go by. She has no explanation.
Either way, however distraught this elven maiden, or probably not maiden, because let's face it, he was a stripling guard. anyway,
I have a whole new mental image for what she was doing, looking out of her bedroom window now.
So we busted into the prison. We managed to get our way into the like high security area without alerting any guard. Well, without seeing any guards. Unfortunately, getting into the high security area required the use of some relatively loud methods, like punching through doors and using shatter to get through them. But we did manage to get in, find Shadow's brother, spring him, and then flee through the sewers right as the guards were coming down to pursue us from upstairs. And after everybody had, like, so Brieg parted the sewage and the party all jumped down into the now, like, gushy but no longer floating in sewer pit formed there. And as they were escaping, Brieg channeled the powers of his ring one more time to force, we figured it out, it was like 6 million gallons or something. Worth of 7 million gallons, yeah, of that sewage back up through the poop chute and into the pursuing guards' faces at extraordinarily high velocity.
Brieg enacted Plan C, Operation Royal Flush.
Yeah, that is absolutely right.
Which should have been Plan A, but whatever.
It's Plan the one we did. So what? Who cares what letter it was?
And that is where it ended, with us fleeing through the sewer, leaving the elves in a giant pile of prisoner feces
and dead bodies.
A couple of short sort of additions there. You rescued somebody from the asylum.
Right. We're pretty sure Shadow's brother, but he had a mask on, so we couldn't actually talk to him.
Yeah, he
was very excited verbalize
or vocalize. He was very excited to be leaving, and he sort of nodded when you asked if he was Tressen, because, you know, if you're a prisoner in a prison and somebody asks you if you're somebody, you definitely would be honest.
Yep.
no motivation at all to lie to that.
You know, no, I think if I ever run a prison break in real life, and I'm not sure, like I don't have a good description of who I'm rescuing, I might use the wrong name first.
Yeah.
And see, you know.
Are you Steven?
Well, that's too bad, because we're here to rescue a different guy. Steven. Lock him back in.
Okay, so you are... You've headed the way that Brieg headed the last time he escaped from Terran. Via the poop chute, you've sort of avoided swimming through the river of excrement, which I'm sure you're all very thankful for. And you've managed to sort of follow the path down to where it exits.
Oh, what? Harbeck doesn't wear shoes.
No, he doesn't.
Harbeck can run up walls now.
So many parasites right now.
We already had the parasite episode. You're fine.
Harbeck do the run on the side of the wall thing.
So you managed to make it down to where it sort of there's only a very small exit. It was a bit of a tight fit for Brieg to get out. It would be reasonably easy to dig it slightly larger so that Harbeck would fit through, because at the moment he probably wouldn't. I'm not going to make you roll any checks for that. I'm just going to assume that you get to the end of the tunnel and Harbeck isn't going to fit, so you dislodge some rocks and make it so that he can. And you find yourself south of Terran. I've brought up the big map so I can show everybody where you are. You're basically right where the marker is. Down river a ways from Terran. Actually, you're a bit high. Down river a ways from Terran, the Lake Prynne is to your northeast, and you've come out in the forest, in sort of a secluded area. Below where this sewage flows out, there's basically like a big septic pit. It's basically a large area filled with refuse. It's very unpleasant. You're far enough away from Terran that Bree, for a fact, knows that no elves come down here. It's too repugnant and too smelly. So you should be reasonably safe unless people are specifically looking for you. You have no way to know whether they are or not, because the last you saw of anybody who knew or who knew that you were there was the guards who were chasing you, and they may or may not have drowned in 7 million gallons of waste.
Yeah. I wonder what your survival chances are. I mean, they'd have to navigate through the poo to the stairs.
Yep.
Yeah, that's...
If you saw the poo coming and you turned around and ran the other way really fast...
How long do you think it stays up there? It's just concentration, right? Briggs just like three of his inner voices are giggling at his fourth inner voice that's jumping for joy while he concentrates on holding all the poo in the dungeon.
The things that D&D makes you say. I believe it has an effective range of about 100 feet. So basically, yeah. Breed would have stood there until he moved as much of it as he possibly could, and then turned and left.
Yeah, I mean, it drains out as quickly as gravity drains it back out that hole. Which,
yeah.
Okay, maybe they could hold their breath.
It's probably considerably slower than it entered the hole.
Yeah.
There was a lot of force behind it going in, less coming out.
If they were concussed by the force, and like... passed out and breathed poo water, then maybe no one knows what happened. They just think the sewer backed up and killed some guards while they were out at the distraction. No, they probably know what happened. They could probably piece that together.
The entire lower level and killed everyone.
And their really important prisoner is missing, and all the guards happened, like, all the guards who were left in the building happened to be down there. And the doors are broken off. They probably have enough forensic science to put this together.
And poor Joe is found at the bottom of the lake the next day.
It was a very violent plumbing incident.
We heard a sound. We all ran downstairs. There was poo. Just poo everywhere.
Okay. So, you're in this little sort of secluded area with the big septic pit, and the smell is horrendous, and you have a person following you. Now that you're sort of out of the dimly lit dungeon and under starlight, because it is early evening, you get a better look at the features of the man, although he's a bit dirty and grubby. You can see that he has the same sort of pointed... half-elven, but not half-elven, more elven, but strange features that Shadow has. He also has the very pale skin and the silver hair that Shadow has as well.
Is
there any way to get the mask off his face?
Same question. Now that we have a chance to slow down and look at it, is it fastened there, or did they just forge it on his skull?
There seems to be some kind of intricate, like, banding around it. It's... Roll a, let's go with a... What kind of check should I get you to roll for this one? Let me just pull up a character sheet here, because they changed all of the skills on me, and now some of them don't exist, and it's...
Yeah.
Better. Roll an investigation check for me, if you're having a look at his... his muzzle, his mask.
So, while they inspect it, I'm going to ask him, do you know how to get this thing off? Figure yes or no questions, he can probably...
He shakes his head. Horizontally, if that wasn't implied.
Okay. Alright, give us a moment. We're going to see if we can figure it out.
Harvick, it's a trinket. There's a mechanism involved. Brig's pretty good with those. There's also, like, some... It takes a close look to find it. And you're shocked that you're the first person to notice it, because Harvick doesn't notice things very often. But there is tiny writing in a script that you can't read, sort of engraved on the metal bands around the back of the mask.
Brig.
Yes?
Brig, can you read that?
Is it in Elvish?
Yes. It is in Elvish.
And I will squint real hard and then read it.
Furthermore, it's not just in Elvish, it's in a version of High Elvish, most commonly used in arcane magics.
Oh, this is magic script. Let me see how much of it I can decipher.
You can roll an arcana check. Minimum result is 19. It's a warding spell of some description. You can't tell the exact nature of, like, whether it's a warding alarm or a warding trap or some other kind of ward, whether it's designed to keep the mask gone or keep things off the mask. It's very hard to tell.
I was really hoping it just said, in case the prisoner needs to eat.
Can I offer any help on that?
Well, so I'm fairly certain that it's some sort of warding spell, but I can't quite figure out if what its goal is, if it's just part of the locking mechanism or if it's some sort of alarm or trap. I don't know if... Do you have any ideas? Let me tell you what the script says as best as I can figure out. Maybe you can lend your magical mind to see if you can help.
Tavern doesn't have much more luck.
Any ideas there, to I forgot your name already. T name that ends in N.
Remember his Tresson.
Hair? Tresson.
Are his hands bonded?
Did you perhaps overhear anything while they were putting it in place or anything like that?
What about dispel magic?
He shakes his head again.
Tavern, you can
what's that?
Turn other people's spells off, right?
Right, I'm just preparing myself, gathering some pieces here. And now I need to roll a charisma. Is it unskilled charisma?
I believe so.
I have the spellbook open right here. Dispel magic.
Are Tresson's arms binding together?
An ability check using your spellcasting ability. So, yes, unskilled.
That's an excellent roll.
Lower than 13th level. Whoa.
That's everything,
anything
right?
Outside spells of divine only go magic.
To nine.
Yeah.
Spells, traditional magic spells that a traditional person can get go to spell level of 9th. Divine magic.
Some artifacts or whatever.
Yeah, and artifacts can go beyond. So.
It seems like dispel magic is
23.
A little overpowered. You need like a 14 on the dice if you have a really high casting stat. to dispel literally anything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Dispel is really, really good. Fortunately, it doesn't work on a lot of things that I throw at you. So, Tabarin says a few words, and you see the crackling dark energies erupt around the back of the mask, and Tressen remains calm through the entire procedure. And as the magic's clear, you see the bands actually sort of retract and melt away into the face mask itself, disappearing from sight. And as that happens, you see Tressen bring his hand up to his mouth and hold the face mask on.
Oh, do you not want us to take that off?
He sort of shakes his head slightly and points down to like the edge of your shirt.
Does he want something to tie the mask on with? I'll give him a
scrap of cloth. I think he's trying to tell us something.
And help him tie it on if he wants.
You give him a scrap of cloth?
Yeah.
Okay. He takes a scrap of cloth in one hand, and he sort of removes the mask. And like as he does so, he turns away from you and wraps the cloth around his face, covering sort of from just below his nose, around his mouth to his chin, and then turns back to you.
Like a bandana?
And sort of stretches a little bit, kind of like a bandana, but I imagine it's more of a straight piece of cloth than a big triangle.
Yes.
Hardik's a monk, not a cowboy.
So, friend.
Can we just call him T the Bandit?
Do you have a preferred way of communicating with people? Because we would like to ask your advice on the next phase of our journey, and perhaps we should tell you why we're here.
We should probably tell who we are and why we're here. And
paper and pencil?
You can tell he's sort of smiling in a really condescending way underneath his mask. Like, the corner of his eyes just sort of turn up slightly as if he's amused by your concern and attempts.
I think he can talk. It was just the mask was on. He didn't want us to... He can't talk through the mask and wanted to cover his face. And now that he has a cloth over his mouth, I think he can talk.
And so he sort of takes in a big deep breath and sort of looks up at the sky, and then you hear something, but you don't hear anything. It's like there's a sound, but there's no sound. It's inaudible, but there's pressure in your ears, like you're hearing a sound, and it's incredibly unsettling. And as he does that, he sort of waves his hand in some delicate maneuvers in the sky above you, like in front of his face, and you see a really delicate silver elven script sort of form out of nothingness in the sky, and it glitters with this white silver light. Like very much resembling the stars above it. And the elven script, which
I will
one
translate.
Of the party can read, simply says, "Does anybody here speak elven?"
I will tell him in elven, "I do."
He continues the same thing, and you can see his lips moving almost imperceptibly beneath the cloth mask that he's wearing, and another line of script appears in front of him, which just says, "I'm Tressen. Why are you looking for me?"
"Your brother sent us."
He turns away for a moment, and you can't see his face, but he's obviously struggling with something. And when he turns back, he flicks his hand, and another short and more abrupt and slightly more coarse line of script appears in the sky. What do you want?
Well, our primary goal was just to get you out of that place. Our next task is to liberate Felagor from the Eternal King's menagerie. Shadow suggested that you might be able to help with that, but you're, of course, free to do as you will.
He flicks his hand one last time, and another line of script appears, and he walks away from it, and it just reads, "I need some time." Fair enough. And he walks off into the forest.
So I say kind of loudly after him, "We can't just wait here."
We're covered in poop.
Well, and I think it's safest to assume that the elves will be coming this way. And that they will do something about that poop shoot now that they know it's an avenue for escape. The first time, I don't think they know how I got out, but we were much less subtle this time.
Brig, what did he say?
He said he needs some time.
Okay. Is it safe to assume that he'll catch us up in Iliander?
I don't know if he intends to catch us up at all.
But I think my point is, staying here is probably a terrible idea. And we might as well head for Iliander, because he seems like one of those mysteriously powerful people that shows up exactly as he's needed. Which seems very... it seems like something out of the story to say that, but I mean, that's exactly what Shadow does, so maybe it's genetic. Right,
but Shadow is also never captured by the elves and taken to their private hell. I don't know that. I mean, he's obviously powerful. If Shadow thinks that he can help us with our mission concerning the Felagor, but he was also captured by the elves, so I don't know that he's just mysteriously all-powerful like Shadow appears to be.
Why isn't Shadow helping us save the Felagor?
I need you to all roll me a wisdom saving throw, please.
Oh.
While you're sitting there, discussing.
Wait, I think I'm extra good at these. Hang on, I need to read my character sheet real quick.
Yeah, I rolled double digits. It's pretty good for me.
Oh, that's okay. I found the thing that I thought I was doing.
If I should point out, if you're resistant to mind altering effects, charms, etc., then you'll have
advantage.
Well, you'll have advantage if you would have advantage, or you don't have to roll if you would roll.
So, I can spend an action to end a charm or frighten effect, but I guess it does affect me for, like, one round.
Yeah.
This is a magical effect, right?
All of a sudden, yes.
I do have advantage on it. Okay. I still got a 13.
Dab's gonna miss the explanation. This makes me sad. All of a sudden, mid conversation, you...
Oh, that didn't work at all. All the cameras are in all the wrong places now.
Oh, dear. Mm-hmm. Okay, so, all of a sudden, mid conversation, you feel a similar effect to when Shadow was talking. This sort of pressure of hearing but not hearing any noise. But this time, you don't so much hear a noise as feel a noise. And it's much more intense, and it's just these waves of anguish and pain washing across the landscape in this inaudible shockwave that literally, for some of you, specifically Harbic, Brieg, and Gergintius, will completely knock you out. Harbic, because of your stillness of mind, I'll say that you're completely incapacitated for a turn and feel the effects even more severely than your comrades, who actually fell unconscious because they were saved the worst of it. But it's intense. The most intense empathic experience you've ever felt in your adventuring lives. The loss of Rogar, the experiences in Grebe's twisted realm, none of it comes close to what you just felt emanating across the landscape. And unfortunately, Babs missed that whole explanation. Babs, there was a very, very nasty feeling and a shockwave that blew across the landscape, and you need to roll a wisdom save to see whether it knocks you out or whether you just feel it.
I rolled my wisdom before I disconnected. Did it not make it?
I got a 21. You saved. I just missed the roll. So yay! You're okay. But Harbic, that was... Funnily enough, even though, like, the stillness of mind benefit is supposed to be a way to, you know, shake off mind-altering effects, in this case, it allowed you to experience it in its full glory as opposed to...
Sorry, if you're not hearing the feedback, it's probably your microphone. Is everyone hearing that?
I'm getting a little feedback, yeah.
Yeah. So maybe it's like...
I can hear it. But I will...
I don't know who it is then. If you can't hear it, it's you.
Muting myself.
There it goes. Right, so...
Might have actually been me.
Harbeck was feeling the thing.
Yes. So, that just happened. Massive shockwave of pain and anguish that literally knocked some of you out.
So the way stillness of mind there works is I'm incapacitated briefly because it was a charm effect. And it was horrible because I was not supposed to be conscious.
Basically, yeah. Yeah.
And so who else went down? Brieg is down and Tabrin is down.
No, Tabrin, I'm immune.
Tabrin's immune. Brieg and Gergintius both go down.
Harbeck staggers and stumbles.
Go over.
Forces himself back to his feet. That was a bit rude.
I think that was a moment Tressen needed to purge. Some pent up energy and pain from being in the asylum.
Sure, but why purge it at us? We rescued him.
I don't think he has control over how it purges.
Well,
he works through sound.
I volunteer to carry Brieg. Let's go find a place to wash ourselves off.
Harbeck throws Brieg over his shoulder. Do I know there's a lake here? Do we know about Lake Prin? Have I seen a map?
You do, yeah. Alright. Yeah, it was east of Terran. You're very familiar with it.
Alright, so Harbeck wanders toward Lake Prin, whistling for Boozy, hoping that Boozy and Steed are nearby.
Sorry, Tavern.
I was just going to say, if we need to head another direction, I can work on getting us cleaned off bit by bit. Prestidigitate people clean over the next 5 minutes.
That would work.
Din's already like...
Din's what?
Yay, swimming!
Oh.
Din's already... She just jumped in the lake. This seems like a good idea. Wet.
Brig, you'll wake up. Gargantius, how are you moving Gargantius? Who's got that job?
Hardback volunteered to carry Brig. Nine strength.
Din and Tavern can figure out Gargantius. Hardback carries Brig.
I probably have more strength than Tavern. I think it's me dragging him by the ankles.
Not thrown over the shoulder like a sack of potatoes as one might carry an adult human, but rather cradled gently like a baby in his arms. Covered with the blanket of his beard.
I could probably attempt to pick up his sword and shield or something.
By the least gooey bit and dragging it across the ground.
So it won't take long. A minute or so passes, and Brig, you wake up to the warm embrace of Harbeck and a face full of beard hair. And Gargantius, you are being dragged unceremoniously across the ground by your ankle.
Golden beard.
Where? What? Why? And then I look up. Oh, hi. How's it going?
Hi. Gonna be better once we're pooped.
Yes.
No. Justin. Are we ever? The world is ending, remember?
Alright. I mean, safe from, you know, that Shadow Brother guy. I'm starting to doubt your guys' faith in Shadow and his family.
You were knocked out by what had happened. What was really going on was quite painful on Tresson's end, as he was, I'm sure, inadvertently purging his pain and emotions and memories of torturous events while he had been locked up. If you felt what he felt, you'd realize it wasn't a malicious attack by any means.
I knew, but, you know, as his saviors, you'd have think maybe he would write an elven whatever to Brig, cover your ears, or something.
I don't know that covering our ears would have helped. It seemed to sort of bypass the usual channels for getting sound into a person's head.
Carry on. I'm gonna whistle for Steed, like, you know, the way I usually call him.
Whoa.
Okay. The journey to the lake doesn't take too long, and on the journey, Tavern is prestidigitating. I hate that word. Prestidigitation. He's cleaning you with magics. That's much easier to say.
Did, but yeah.
Yeah, too many dids, you're right. Prestidigitation.
Wasn't blinding us, but...
So by the time you get to the lake, you're all cleaned off anyway. Now, if you want to avoid Terran, you're going to have to stick to the east bank of the lake and then travel through the forest, or you're going to have to go hard west across the plains.
So my general plan that I haven't told anyone yet, but my general plan was they probably expect us to go this way or possibly this way, to be not in Elflands as quickly as possible.
Yeah. Or
possibly, you know, any sort of vector in between those two to just get to the ocean, maybe. So if we instead go this way, we will probably lose them, and we can just skirt the edge of the forest all the way over to Iliander, kind of like that.
Okay.
That's what Harbeck is thinking as he heads for the lake. You know, like, that's not out of the way to go get cleaned off. Because, we want to go around the lake anyway to stay away from Terran and go a direction they don't expect us to go.
It's not a bad idea. So
that's the plan, then?
Yeah, I think...
Seems reasonable.
All right, then. Heck, we could just walk through the lake.
You could just walk through the lake if Breed was willing to risk trying to cast a spell with his ring again. But we're heading around the lake. Okay. By the time you reach sort of the edge of the forest, it's nearing on midnight. It's been a fairly long and tiring day. Between the underwater fights and the taking of the ship and the escape and then the weird empathic shockwave thing that happened to you, you're all feeling fairly exhausted. You're still fairly close to Terran, though. It would be very difficult to get far away from Terran because you're sort of going to be circling around it.
I have an idea.
Is there anything we can do to attempt to cover our tracks as we move?
I am going to regret every single word that comes after this one. Brig's water breathing spell lasts 24 hours. Might we not just sleep at the bottom of the lake?
You're right. Horrible idea.
Yeah, I told you it was a terrible idea and I regret every single word. But it's probably the best way to hide from the elves. They certainly don't expect to find us sleeping at the bottom of the lake.
Yeah, I'd rather not have my skin nibbled off by...
fish.
I don't know that I would go quite that far. However, if we were willing just to, instead of skirting around the shore of the lake, walk straight across it, that will give us a couple of miles of not leaving any tracks.
We just attack.
All right, we can do water walk.
That's a good idea. If we were to just skirt across,
right, so we could really just around the lake, we just walk right across it and we can camp
cut across
on the other
there.
Side. I think that sleeping under the water is a bit more than I would like to do.
A great idea.
Yeah, I think if we just skirted across that little bit of the north end of the lake.
Who hates my sister?
Mm-hmm.
Really does.
All gone.
So what's the plan then? Is that...
So I think that's a good way to cut our trail.
We walked up to the... Yeah, so we're
imagine
cut across the...
Sorry. Proceed.
Go ahead.
Tabrin, shouldn't we walk across the closest part of the lake so our tracks disappear as soon as possible? I don't trust us to go much faster than the elves.
Except we didn't start formulating this plan until the DM said that we were here already.
I mean...
Oh. Right.
Oh, we got there in like one night's walk. Yeah, never mind.
Yeah, it was... You walked around the edge of the lake, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, across the lake, starting now. Seems like a great plan.
Just skirting there.
Okay. The water-breathing spell that you cast earlier, Brieg, will still be in effect.
Yes.
So you guys can just trudge on straight through the water.
Let's do it.
Right.
We'll need to help Gargantius along and those that can't see in the dark very well.
Gargantius.
That's just Gargantius.
I'm for that.
Wait, what about Boozy and Steed?
Yeah, they can't breathe through water.
You haven't found Boozy.
Did we actually ever get them?
Oh, no!
Oh, we haven't.
No, all my stuff is on Boozy. Oh, it's terrible.
Should we go look for them first? I mean, we are where I sent them, right? Like, downriver?
Well, not anymore.
Yeah, we were.
We were.
They weren't
there. We were.
We didn't find them.
It's gonna be so expensive to replace all the stuff that was confiscated from Boozy.
My companion is gone. Didn't you have your rock pet on Boozy?
Nope. He stays in my pocket.
No?
Mash is always right here close to my heart.
I guess if we're underwater, we can't really talk.
All the brewing supplies, all of the...
Yeah.
The bacon.
Packs and wealth.
Oh,
and
no.
Booze and bacon and everything.
Yeah, that's really bad.
Booze and bacon. I love my memoir.
That's really bad.
We have to go back for the bacon.
So, I imagine as we go underwater, it gets really quiet, like anyone who has been underwater would have experienced. And, walking through a lake, I would guess we have an hour or two?
About an hour.
Of complete silence. And that gives Harbeck time to think, and he can't talk to other people to distract himself from thinking, which is his usual defense mechanism. So... I will think about what Harbeck is thinking while we walk, because it's probably not good.
Before we get in the water, I'm gonna get my little sprite friend, Sprig, and just instruct him to see if he could go out and locate Boozy and Steed. And then lead them back to me. I imagine with the tie that I have, him finding me would be
innate, yeah.
Fairly easy.
That's not a problem. Innate.
So I'll let everyone know that I've sent out something to look for them and bring them to us, assuming they're free and roaming and not captured.
Okay. The rest of the time underwater passes basically in silence. I mean, the only person capable of communicating down there is Tabrin, with message spells. Otherwise, it's dark and quiet and still. And reasonably slow going because you are moving underwater, which is quite difficult. Fortunately, most of you sink. Compliments of all of the metal and stuff that you carry around. Harbeck struggles a little bit.
Harbeck's pretty staying dense on the bottom.
But he manages reasonably well. You'll be able to come out from the lake just here in the foothills east of Taran, it's a reasonably hilly area, and you can find a secluded sort of exit point from the lake where you won't be spotted. You're also, you know, about a mile away from Taran, so far enough away. As far as you're aware, the only guards left in Taran were either sent north from Taran, about 3 or 4 miles up to where the prisoner happened to escape, or would be traveling south to find out what happened to those pesky intruders that filled their asylum with poo. So, you should be reasonably safe to the east of Taran. That would be a reasonable assumption. Of course, that's not, you know,
guaranteed.
Not guaranteed.
The whole plan was they would never expect us to go this direction.
Underwater, even. I mean, once they hit that forest edge, they're going to be like, okay, where'd they go?
So are you guys going to continue to push on? It's now late. 1 in the morning.
I suggest we find ourselves a nice secluded glen and camp for the night.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyone trained in survival? To try and locate...
Din is.
Yes.
I am.
I know Din is, but...
I am too.
I'm just real bad at it.
Okay, well... Oh, Gergintius is excellent at it.
I am too, okay. And I'm kind of okay at it. I'm not as good as Gergintius.
So Gergintius finds a nice, secluded, out-of-the-way place. You won't be able to light a fire. You're going to be sleeping wet. It's reasonably warm this time of year, so it's not the end of the world. But you'll be able to get some rest. The next question is, are you going to have watches and who's going to take them? There's not enough time for a long rest before morning if you want to set out early, but you can definitely get in enough sleep that you'll feel rested enough to continue moving tomorrow. So
I can take a short first watch.
I can take I guess the first and a second. Gergintius has a lot of on his mind.
Okay.
Anyone up for a third?
I will get.
Check third watch. It seems to me that we should probably take a full 8 hours if we can. We want to be at full strength, just in case. And this is as safe a spot as any.
Gergintius, did you want to take just one watch, or...?
I'll start with the first. I'll wake you up at the second.
For the second.
Okay. But I might still stay up with you.
Okay. Well, we'll find out what happens with those perception rolls and what's going to happen next in our next episode. If you're watching on YouTube, the next video will be up shortly. If you're watching on Twitch, we'll be back in about 3 minutes. But until next time, we'll see you then.
Bye.